Hello, malty. Mesmerising, mirthful, magnificent malt mates. Yeah, it's you. And thank you to Pipes, etc. for that malt mention. I'm Ralfy. This is the Bothy Ralfy Review 830. And I've just put a match out and generated a little bit of smoke in the Bothy while I did so. You probably noticed. So even before I pour this dram, I've got a little bit extra smoke in the environment. Lagavulin, 12-year-old, cask strength, 56.5% of 12-year-old Lagavulin. It's not particularly sherried. Does that look like a natural colour to you? Certainly does to me. Tell you something else. When you add water to it, you get a good, healthy covering of Scotch mist. They haven't said so. They should have. It would help. But I think this is an integrity bottling that's been undeclared. Now, I've had a big, big problem with this whisky, malt mates. Where will I start? The big problem is that since I've opened the bottle, I've been drinking a glass almost every second night and discovering new, subtle, undetected flavour notes in what is, in my opinion, one of the finest accessible or younger bottlings of Lagavulin that I've come across in the last 10 years. Now, I haven't had the facial bottlings. Oh, hang about, I should have a wee smell and taste before I add the water. But there aren't that many Lagavulins available. We tend to start with the 16-year-old standard bottling. And because there's very few permutations of Lagavulin, unless you've got a very deep wallet, then you're really stuck with the 16-year-old and occasionally the distiller's edition, and every now and again, possibly a decent independent bottling, but they're few and far between, very few and far between, and frequently totally overpriced, particularly for the quality. But if you've not been to Facile and tried the Facile bottling, your range of Lagavulin experiences is kind of restricted. But recently, a couple of years ago, they brought out this as an ongoing kind of small batch, relatively small batch, for those of their customers who actually stop to smell, taste and properly enjoy the whisky. The sort of customers like you and I who do not go to style bars and expect our single malts to be dressed up in a cocktail with apple juice and mint. And we're getting told it's a smokestack fire from the Western Isles, whatever name it is. And then they ask for £15 for the concoction. We're not those kind of customers, malt mates. We're slow sippers, steady nosers, and we use glasses that actually work for the experience. So what's it like? There's that peatiness. Of course there is. It's Lagavulin. It's from Islay. But do you know one of the biggest mistakes that people make when they talk about descriptors of Lagavulin? They talk about it as a peaty whisky, when in fact it's a smoky whisky with peat in it. Lagavulin is primarily a smoky whisky, but it's also got peat there. But too many people put the peat and the smoke together, and then they can't really properly access the smell and the taste of this whisky because they don't have the references. You've just got to look at the stills. I recommend that you go on to open a search page and just put Lagavulin stills and then click images. Look at those stills. Forget the capacity. Forget the size and the direction of the line arm, or whether it's worm tub cooled or coil cooled or sleeve cooled or whatever. Just look at the stills. They are the fattest, badass stills that you're going to find anywhere in Scotland. And that's what gets the smoke across. Because smoke are heavy phenols in with the peat. And in so many distilleries, the smokiness gets lost because there's too much reflux in the narrow necks of the stills. Nobody's going to tell you this, malt mates, except the people who have worked at the distilleries for years and years and years and years and years. And these are the people that, more often than not, they're not even doing the tours. Thought I'd share that with you. Minty, gingerbread, pickle, apple pickle. Loads of phenols, crispy, seaweedy, iodine. Tell you something, another thing. Tell you one thing and another thing. Lagavulin is always referred to as the Prince of Islas. Well, I think they're getting ideas above their station at Diageo. Because it's stating here in the label, and I quote, the King of Islay. The King of Islay. No, no. Ardbeg is the King of Islay. Lagavulin is the Prince. The Dark Prince of Islay. Because it's primarily sherry matured. This isn't. It's much more bourbon matured. And it's working an absolute treat with these decent first fill casks. 12 years old. You've still got that elemental nature. You've still got those heavy, heavy phenols that are not being broken down over time in the cask. I'm just telling you, see, the old days, when they weren't ashamed of bottling Lagavulin at 4, 5, 6 years old and stating it in the label. Those are absolutely cracking whiskies. They have aged so well in the bottles. It's no wonder people are collecting them. Anyway, taste. Did I say 56.5% volume? You certainly notice it in the taste. Super rich, very syrupy, vanilla drenched. Not that you really notice with the overtness of the peat and the phenols and the smokiness. And the flavour initially, it's the peat that's coming through because it's the first to be activated once you add a little drop of water and you gently stroly-poly around in the glass. But over time, and it's just the magic of the smoke. It's very rare to have a whiskey where the smoke is so articulate that you actually noticing the smoke notes changing over time. But it's happening in this. I've had so much enjoyment as a seasoned old hack that never gets too excited about things these days. Comes with experience, but, and it's not just of whiskey, it's just of life. But this is such a fantastic, unexpectedly so fantastic version of Lagavulin. And the cask strength is taking what's there and really pushing it out over time in a way that weaker bottled versions at 43 or 46%, if you're lucky, just cannot do. Back to the nose. Softened melon, some ripe figs, a little bit of sour grapefruit. More phenols, more smoke. Did I say phenols and smoke? Yep. Times two. Times three. Something herbaceous in there. Herbaceous. Slightly seaweedy. Maritime. But of course, it's not matured by the sea. But it's coming through. I think it's just a version of that peatiness with its green notes. You find the same in Kulila. It can be quite marine at times. Lemon oil. Some sawdust. Aromatic. Hugely aromatic. It's an absolute monster of a dram. A peat monster? Yeah, totally, but it's peat and smoke monster. It's that smokiness. That's what really comes out, because you don't encounter it in other whiskies, except for very rarely. I think the last time I had a really nice smoky whisky was Benromic peat smoke. That was a good one. Taste. Huge arrival. Doesn't develop hugely in the development sector after the arrival. Tends to kind of hold on to the same notes. And it's really the finish where it starts to separate, such as the phenolic, acidic, blast of sensation on the arrival. It really numbs the palate. You wouldn't leave have this whiskey until the end of the night. Then you'll probably sleep like a log. A burnt log. Couldn't resist it. But it's the latter part of the experience. The development into the finish is when this whiskey is becoming so interesting, because such is the volume of smokiness that it starts to separate from the peatiness and become more singular. You get chimney soot smoke, you get wood fire smoke, you get nighttime ember smoke, you get first thing in the morning smoke. The array of versions of smokiness is really very impressive and very successfully delivered in this more peated, this more bourbon matured version of Lagavulin at a great age for it. Because with a signature coming off the stills such as Lagavulin has, it really doesn't need all sorts of cask conditioning. It just doesn't need it at all. In fact, it can damage it. One more sip, eh? Intense ginger cake. Mint green fennel. Bitter licorice, coal tar, iodine, coal tar, road tar, salty smoke, and we'll leave it at that. Malt marks. I suspect, malt mates, you know this is going to be a good one. It is. It has far exceeded my expectations. I think Diageo in this instance, given their standard operating patterns of not disclosing natural colour and chill filtration, non-chill filtration, when it's presumed that they do it throughout their products, to respond with presenting an honest, transparent, very accessible and fascinating version of Lagavulin for the real whisky customers is something that should be applauded and recognised, with 91 points out of 100. Malt mark. I'm going to add a bit more water to this to see if I can coax out 5 mil. I've put 10 mil of water in this, but it's a huge, huge whisky. I think you can start to see the Scotch mist appear in that glass. Look at that colour. Just look at that colour. Is that not a fantastic colour? That is a fabulous colour. So rich. So so honest. Minerally, when you add water to now, when you're taking it down towards wine strength, the sudden weakness of the ability of the alcohol to hold on to the flavours accelerates the release of flavours, which you pick up on some in smell, but most in taste. And you notice the more clearly the sensation range that's going on. Because with peat, you'll always get fractional bitterness, the bitter-sour combination, which can often be mistaken for citrus, but it's working wonderfully well here. I'm Ralfy, I'm done and dusted. I hope you've enjoyed this. I've enjoyed presenting it. It clearly showed. and there you have it. If you pop back again for Ralfy Review 830 extras, I'll be talking about this. I'll be telling you all about this. Insider stuff, new stuff, fresh stuff, and how it all happened. I'm Ralfy. Thank you for watching. Where's my clicker? Whoops, found it. And I'll see you soon, malt mates.